Welcome back to another episode of The Road Shows Me. My name's Dan Grech, and today a topic that I know everyone is worried about. What is it really like to cross an international border when you've got your own vehicle? So I've driven across 55 of them or so by now, all through Latin America, all the way around Africa. And I know lots of people hype this up. They make it seem really scary, really dangerous. And I want to completely debunk that. And I'm going to walk you through step by step of exactly what it's like. What paperwork do you need? How are people going to treat you? How do you figure out the steps that you need to do? If you're looking at taking your overlanding internationally, stick around. I'm going to get into all the important details right now. So I want to start out with some high-level tips that are really going to make your border crossing smoother. And the first one's really simple. Make sure you show up early in the morning. If the border opens at 9, lots of them do, make sure you're there between 9 and 10. This is just going to give you way more time to figure out all of the steps, and there'll be no stress. It's not like it's going to get dark soon. You're not worried about getting away from the border region or finding a place to camp. So arrive first thing in the morning. Before you even get to the border earlier that day, put everything away in your vehicle that you're not going to need. Put your GPS out of sight, your iPhone, the charging cables, all of that kind of stuff. Lock them away in your glove box, in your lock boxes. Same story, if you wear a big gold watch, if you've got lots of jewelry, take it all off, put it all away. You don't need to advertise the fact that you have money and that you have things like an iPhone. You're not going to need it while you're at the border, so don't worry about it. Another tip on that, before you get to the border, so the morning of, if you really want to, read through iOverlander for the border that you're going to and read through what other people have said about that border crossing. A lot of the updates in there, they're so specific. They even have like, go to the blue building on this side of the road. When you're done there, go to the orange building on the other side of the road, so on and so forth. So it's really like the cheat codes for how to cross that individual border. So what I'll do now is I'll walk you through exactly how border crossings go down. And sometimes I'll use specific country names, but what I really want to emphasize is this is exactly how it has been for me in every single land border all around the world. Once you've done two or three of them, they're so similar, it really does become routine, and it's not something you need to stress or worry about. It actually becomes quite easy. So for this example, let's just say you're in Central America and you're trying to cross from Belize into Guatemala. Just hypothetically, but substitute any countries in the world, it's going to be the same thing when you're on land. Obviously, before you can get into Guatemala, you have to actually get out of Belize legally. So how do you do that? You're going to be driving along, your GPS will have the road, right up until you're about maybe 100 yards from the legal border. There'll be some sort of barrier or a gate, and you're going to see a cluster of buildings that'll start to look familiar and kind of people milling around. So you're going to find a place to park, whether that's some sort of large parking area or it's literally on the shoulder of the road, whatever it takes, park your vehicle, grab your documents, jump out and lock your vehicle. You're going to do all of this on foot while you're leaving the first country. The first thing you normally do is you go to immigration and you get yourself stamped out of the country that you're already in. And so there'll be a sign, Migraciones or immigration or whatever it says. You've got your passport, walk in there and basically you get in the line for exit. If it's a busy border, if there's people around, there'll be an entry line and an exit line. You find the exit line, you're trying to leave, stand in line if there's other people. When you get to the front, they're gonna have a look at your entrance stamp, make sure you haven't overstayed, give you an exit stamp and give you your passport back. And that's it, you're free to go. You are now legally out of the country. The next thing you need to do is wander over to customs, wherever that happens to be. Again, there's going to be a sign or you can ask the guys in immigration, or if there's a policeman out the front with a badge and a gun, just ask him, aduana, where is it? You know, donde está aduana? He's gonna point in the right direction. Wander into that building with the paperwork you've got from your vehicle and they're going to stamp it. Again, they might check the dates, make sure you haven't overstayed. And 99 times out of 100, they're going to keep the paperwork and they're going to say, yep, you're good to go. And that really is it. You can legally leave the country now. Sometimes they might give you a little scrap of paper with a stamp on it or something. And that's what you're actually going to show the person who's manning the boom gate or the gates or whatever happens to be there. If it's a really tiny border, like tons of the ones I crossed in Africa, there isn't even anything like that. The guy who's manning the boom gate, he's seen you walk into immigration, he's seen you walk into customs. He knows that you can now leave and they're gonna open the boom gate for you. And the way that it works in most places in the world is there's kind of a no man's land between the two countries. Sometimes it might only be 50 yards, sometimes it could be 500 yards or further. But in any case, you're always going to jump back in your vehicle and you're going to physically drive it from the first country into the second country. And like I said, there might be a boom gate, there might not be, but you're going to pull forward until it's reasonably obvious you're at the entrance of the next country. Again, there's going to be pretty similar looking buildings, pretty similar looking people milling about, and you're going to find somewhere to park your vehicle. If it's a busier border, someone might try to wave you to park in a specific spot. Otherwise, you just find a spot on the side of the road, or you just park anywhere when it's a tiny border in Africa and there's nobody around. But in any case, you now just repeat the process in reverse. So the first thing is to get yourself legally stamped in at immigration. And again, look for the building with the sign. You can look to the guy who is manning the gate. He'll point you in the right direction. Remember, these people are here to help you. They're not gonna try and hinder you or just stand around and laugh at you while you don't know where to go. That's not how this works. People aren't mean for no reason. So wander into immigration. Now, obviously, you wanna be in the entrance line. If you're in a busy country like Costa Rica, there's probably going to be a lineup of other people entering. So you just wait your turn in line, whatever that takes. When you get to the front of the line, they're going to give you a stamp and you'll be legal in the country for 30 days or 60 or 90 or whatever that country gives you. The only slight technicality here is this works for all the countries where you don't need to get a visa beforehand or you just issued a visa on arrival. It works just like I said. But if you're going somewhere like West Africa, you're going to need to organize a visa beforehand. You cannot get it at the border for many countries. And if you show up, they're not going to let you in. So I did a whole video about how to get visas. Head over there if you want to travel somewhere in the world where you need to get visas beforehand. Watch that video and then come back. But in any case, if you're entering Guatemala or Costa Rica or whatever sort of easy country, they'll stamp you in. Even if it's a country where you got a visa, they'll find the visa page and then they'll still stamp you in. Now you're legal in the country. That's great. Now you can deal with the vehicle. So wander over again to customs in this new country. There'll be a sign. It's a pretty obvious building. And when you're going to customs, you can basically just say, I'm a tourist. I have a vehicle. I'd like to enter the country, please. That's really all you need to say, and they know exactly what that means. They've processed literally tens of thousands of foreigners who've driven through their country with a vehicle. So this is not strange to them. This is an everyday occurrence. They will almost immediately pull out a piece of paper called your temporary import permit. Lots of people call it a TIP. And that's the document that's gonna make your vehicle legal in the country. And sometimes they'll fill it in if you hand over your registration or your title card, or sometimes when they're being lazy, they'll just give it to you and they'll have you fill it in. It's really mundane stuff. The VIN number, the make, the model, what are the license plates, what color is it, how many seats does it have? Just fill it all in. Most of them are on paper. I think I've only ever crossed one or two borders where they've done it on a computer. But in any case, now this whole document is filled out. They might come outside and ask for a look around the vehicle, even just to check the license plates are correct. I think one time someone wanted to see the VIN number to make sure that it was correct, but realistically, the chances of them wanting to see it are really low. If they do want to have a look inside the vehicle, I know lots of people are worried about this. I've had it maybe five times in all of my travels. I open the back door, I point to a few things, I say, these are camping supplies, these are clothes, this is food. They look around and they say, okay, close it up. That is it. I've never had anyone try to rifle through stuff. No one's really wanted to pull lots of stuff out. So you don't need to worry about them wanting to kind of rifle through all of your belongings. So back inside at customs, the TIP is complete. They're gonna stamp it, they're gonna sign off on it, they give you the piece of paper and say, now you're free to go in the country for 30 days, have a good trip. And that's it, you're legally inside the country. Once again, the only small difference that can happen here is if it's a country that requires you to buy insurance at the border. So if you don't already have a policy that covers you for lots and lots of countries, and again, I did a video about this. If you want to learn more, you can sometimes get policies for many countries. But if it's a country that just says you have to buy it from our country, before they'll finalize the TIP, customs are going to tell you that. They're going to point and say, go and buy insurance. And there'll be a little shack, there'll be a dude or a lady selling insurance. You can just walk over there, it'll be 20 yards. And again, using the title of your vehicle or your registration, whatever document you have that, you know, says you're the legal owner of vehicle described here as VIN number, blah, blah, blah. Take that over to them. They're going to again fill out a little piece of paper and you're going to buy insurance from them. It's usually about $10 a month, maybe $20 a month at a stretch. So you buy some insurance, they'll give you a little piece of paper proving that. Then you walk back over to customs and show them and they say, oh, now you have insurance. That's great. Here's your TIP. Now you're free and clear to go. So that really is it. Now you're legally inside the next country. Another small modification on that is if you're using a carnet de passage, which for all of Central and South America is not valid and won't work. For most of Africa, it will work. Central Asia, it will work. Again, I've got a separate video on carnet de passage. If you're thinking of going to Central Asia or Africa, you need to learn about that. But if you've got a carnet de passage, instead of having to fill out a temporary import permit and writing down all the mundane details, you literally just go into customs and say, I have a carnet de passage. They'll know what to do. And even when they don't, I watched my German friends explain it to a couple of border guards in Nigeria and Cameroon. You just find a page, they stamp the in section, they get to tear off and keep a little piece. And that's it. That's all you have to do to make the vehicle legal in that country. And you're off and away. And when you're leaving, again, they just stamp it. So there'll be a matching in and out stamp from whatever country you happen to be in. And that's it. That's all you have to do when you have a carnet de passage. So it does make the process much simpler. But as I say in the other video, a carnet de passage can be quite expensive and it can be difficult to get, has a whole bunch of strange restrictions around it. So I personally have never traveled with one because I think it's too annoying, but depending on where you're going in the world, you really might have to. But in any case, now you're free and clear, you are legal to drive into that country, you've got yourself legal with your passport, you've got your vehicle legal with your temporary import or your carnet, and that's all there is to it. That really is how the borders go down. And in terms of, is this like a big, overwhelming, scary experience? No, it really isn't. One piece of advice I'll give you though, don't deal with the guys who are trying to snatch your paperwork or who are right in your face telling you, I'll help you across the border, it'll be faster with my help, otherwise it's going to take a long time. These guys are often called border helpers or fixers or tramadors. There's all kinds of names for them. But basically they're just trying to make some money on the side. Supposedly they're going to help you. Of course, there's nothing stopping them from sort of collecting $10 from you at every step along the way. So you never really know if it's helping you or hindering you. My advice, if someone's trying to snatch your paperwork, don't give it to them. Hold on to your documents and only speak to people who are inside buildings behind desks or who are clearly wearing uniforms and badges and guns. Then you know they're actually legit. People always worry also that the borders are going to take a really long time. And that just hasn't been in my experience either. Quite often in Africa, I would get to a very sleepy border and someone would say, ah, the chief is away on lunch. I guess he's always on lunch. And I would grab some cold water out of the fridge. I would grab an apple or a banana. And yeah, maybe I'd sit in the shade for half an hour. But realistically, that's not a big deal. You're just waiting quietly in the shade. Maybe there's someone there to talk to, or maybe there's a lady you can buy street food from. So it's quite relaxing often when you're at a very quiet border. When you're at a busy border, it can sometimes be a bit hectic or a bit bustling. But again, the process is nearly identical. There really aren't that many variations, and it's not a big, overwrought, stressful process. A couple of other things that might be unique to some borders, especially in Central America, they often want you to have your vehicle fumigated. So you have to drive through a shallow puddle of kind of some chemical, maybe they spray something on the inside, and usually they charge you a couple of dollars for this. It's pretty much mandatory and they are going to give you a receipt. Just make sure you get a receipt for your few dollars. Other minor variations, some countries will have you pay for the temporary import permit. And so they'll just have an official fee. Make sure though that you get a receipt for that money, and 9 times out of 10, when you have to pay money, you never give it to the person directly. You actually go to the bank and pay. This is all to cut down on corruption. So even when customs needs $10 for your temporary import permit, you don't just give them $10 cash. They give you a special slip of paper with the right bank details on it. You walk around the corner to a bank, give them the $10, that person deposits it, gives you the proper deposit slip, you get it like signed in triplicate, then you walk back around to customs, you've got proof that you actually deposited it, and then customs will proceed. So yeah, this helps cut down on corruption. Really common in some countries, really common at sort of bigger, more industrial borders where they might be collecting, you know, like import taxes of lots and lots of money from big transport trucks and things like that. So yeah, your temporary import permit, some countries it's $10. I think the most I ever paid was like $16 for a month or something like that in Angola. So it's not a big amount of money. Again, make sure you get a receipt. Another couple of things you can do before you're heading there, make sure you've got a few photocopies of your passport, a few photocopies of your vehicle title or registration. Chances are different officers might want them, and there will be someone there with a photocopier. You can wander over and find them. But if you want things to go as smoothly as possible, have photocopies ready. So when they ask for one, you can just give it to them straight away. You don't have to sort of waste another 10 or 20 minutes finding a photocopier. So I hope that information's been helpful. And more than that, I hope it really, really opens your ideas to the idea that it is not scary, it is not difficult, and you really can figure it out and get it done. Let's be honest, the first time I did this, I was 27 years old, I didn't speak a word of Spanish, I had absolutely no idea what I was doing. I'd never done anything like this, I'd never seen a YouTube video about it, there was no iOverlander, it was long before I'd ever met anyone who'd done it. And guess what? I figured it out and I made it work, and it wasn't even difficult. So if I could manage it back then, I'm really confident that you can manage it now. So if it has been helpful and it does open your ideas to what's possible, please do hit that thumbs up button, subscribe to the channel. New videos come out every Monday and Thursday, exactly like this, teaching you how to take your overlanding global and everything that you need to know. If you'd like to learn more about my upcoming trip, I'm posting all the details over on Patreon right now. These people are helping me bring these videos to you, and they're getting behind the scenes access to all the details of the vehicle I'm building, the continent I'm going to, and what the trip is going to be like, as well as, of course, all the details once the trip is underway. And it's exactly 3 weeks until I fly out. I can't believe it, time is still flying by. So if that's of interest to you, there's a link in the description to my Patreon. Head over there and you'll see all the kinds of information that I'm offering people who support me there. So once again, thanks very much for watching. Stay safe out there, and maybe I'll bump into you on the road.